Good evening to all of you present. We are now commencing the webinar session organized by Spectrum Institute of Science and Technology. SIST has taken steps to facilitate a free webinar session to aid advanced level students to better comprehend syllabus content to successfully face the forthcoming advanced level examination. Today's webinar will be covering basics of molecular biology and genetics. This webinar is specially designed to give a comprehensive understanding of the Unit 7 of the GCE Sri Lankan A-level syllabus covering aspects of molecular biology and recombinant DNA technology. This webinar is also suited for candidates following EdExcel and Cambridge syllabi for advanced level examination. Today's webinar session will be conducted by Mr. Channa Taranga, Senior Lecturer in Immunology and Molecular Genetics, Spectrum Institute of Science and Technology. Mr. Channa has obtained his Master's of Science in Genetic Diagnostics from the Faculty of Medicine, University of Colombo, and completed his BSc in Microbiology, Biotechnology, and Biochemistry from the University of Mysore. I now invite Mr. Channa to conduct the session. Before moving on, I would kindly ask the audience to unmute your mics and turn off videos during the session to avoid any interruptions. Also, the audience can direct any questions during the session by using the chat option that is available. Messages can be directly sent to Mr. Channa Taranga by selecting his name. Over to you, Mr. Chan.
Okay, guys. Welcome all of you. Good evening. And I hope you can see my screen. Azra, just tell me, can you see the presentation, right?
Yes. Can you, full screen mode?
Yes, I'll put it into the full screen. Okay. So, guys, now in this chapter, actually, I don't think we will be able to finish everything in the Unit 7 today itself, but we will try our best to cover at least up to the structure of the chromosome. So, and I want to tell you this now, you can direct any questions to me and I might, give you a break maybe after half an hour or 45 minutes to answer your questions, because I don't want you to, if you have any doubts, better to clear it and move ahead. So in case if I think that you need the urgent answers, I will stop the presentation and I might answer your question. Okay. So now we all know that we inherit our characters, our physical appearance, our physiological appearance, most of the things from our parents, and that is known as the inheritance. And we also know that this inheritance is due to DNA. So DNA is the nucleic acids are the molecule that is responsible for the inheritance. Almost all the organisms except some viruses. So, however, you can see these two guys are the Watson and Crick. They discovered the DNA structure using some of the X-ray crystallography of Rosalind Franklin. So, anyway, we will discuss this later. So, now in early 20th century, there was a big issue to identify what is the molecule of inheritance. You know, we know that there are so many biomolecules. Now we know there are carbohydrates, there are proteins, lipids, nucleic acids. So those times, the scientists also have discovered all of these different types of biomolecules. But the question was, how exactly we can say what molecule is responsible in the inheritance? So, T.H. Morgan, he was able to show that the genes are located on chromosomes. So then the DNA and protein became the candidate for the genetic material. So some people, some scientists suggested that it should be protein. And then some scientists suggested that it should be DNA. So what happened was they wanted to do a few experiments in order to identify which molecule, whether protein or DNA, is responsible for the inheritance. So they study usually about bacteria and viruses because they were very simple and it's easy to study on them. So now the first insight on this genetic material came with the Griffith experiment. Now he worked on two bacteria, actually two strains of Staphylococcus pneumoniae. One version was pathogenic, the other version was non-pathogenic. So they had actually two versions. When they did the culture techniques, when they grow the bacteria on plates, they observed two types of colonies. They saw smooth colonies and rough colonies. They were able to see smooth colonies and rough colonies. So smooth colonies, actually they were pathogenic. So they were known as S and then R, rough colony. So now what happened was, now you can see here there are smooth colonies or S colonies and then there are rough colonies. Actually this smoothness for the colonies, they got this smoothness from their capsule. So because of their capsule, they were able to cause the disease on the healthy organism because they were able to evade the immune mechanism because of this capsule. So when the smooth colonies was given, injected to the mouse, you can see they were killed from the smooth colonies. But the rough colonies couldn't able to kill the mouse. So the mouse was healthy. Then what happened was they heat killed the S strain. Now after the heat stroke, after you kill the S colonies from heat, once you injected them again, the mice were survived. But they saw very different phenomena when they mix S and R together. Heat killed S with R colonies. They mix them together. After mixing them together, when they injected, then they saw, it was lethal to the mouse. And when they extracted the blood samples and when they regrew the organism, they saw, instead of R colonies, they saw living S cells. So what did they do? First, they heat killed S colonies and they injected it with the mouse, and nothing happened. They survived. But once they mixed S with R, that resulted in the death. Not only that, now you injected the dead S cells with living R cells, but once you grow them in the culture plate, you saw living S colony. That means something from the dead S colonies has transformed. Something from the dead S colonies has transformed R colonies also to S. So, this is known as bacterial transformation. This is one way that bacteria send the genetic material between the in the same generation. This is known as horizontal gene transfer. So, somehow, something from the S colonies were able to transform R into S. Now, when Oswald and McCarthy, when they did the experiment to identify what substance exactly transformed R colonies to S, they were able to identify that substance as DNA. Actually, what did they do was they took two samples. They took two samples. In one sample with the dead S colonies, they add proteinase to digest the protein. And the other one, with the S colonies, they add DNAs to digest the DNA. So, sample A, sample B. Sample B could not transform S to R. This was not possible. This was not possible. But in sample A, S colonies were able to transform R colonies into S. S colonies were able to transform R also to R colonies into S colony. This was done when they were add proteinase. So that means when you add DNAs, the DNA was digested. Because of that, the transformation was not possible. Due to the digestion of DNA, the transformation was not possible. But in the sample A, you had only proteinase. So the proteins got digested, but still the DNA was there. Because of that, transformation was possible. Then they also did some test with certain viruses known as bacteriophages or phage. They are actually type of viruses that can infect bacteria cells. So this is the phage head, tail, and then usually they release their DNA into the bacteria cell. So, what happened was, they used T2-phage in their experiment. So, now we know that the other, there were two candidates for the inheritance, DNA and protein. Now, when they look into the the infection when viral particles, when they infect the bacteria, they observe that only one component enter into the bacteria cells. So what did they do was, like, first they use radioactive proteins, and they made the bacteriophage from radioactive protein. So they use radioactive sulfur in order to make the protein radioactive. because you know there are sulfur containing amino acids, so they were able to grow this virus in heavy sulfur media or radioactive sulfur, so all the proteins were radioactive. Then once the bacteria was infected by the virus, they did the centrifugation, and in the centrifugation they were able to separate the capsid material and the bacterial cell separately. You know, part of the virus were remain on the bacteria, so they were able to separate the bacteria and the viral particles. But they did not see any radioactivity inside the bacteria because the DNA was not radioactive. Only the protein was radio labeled. Because of that, they didn't see any radioactivity inside the bacteria, but they saw radio labeled. They were able to detect the radioactivity in the supernatant. Then they used radioactive phosphorus, and once they did the experiment, what happened was after the centrifugation they were able to see radioactive molecules inside the bacteria, and they knew that they have already added radioactive phosphorus to the DNA. So that means the DNA has entered into the bacteria cell during the transduction or during the infection. So that means the genetic materials, actually the inheritance is carried out by DNA. DNA is responsible for the inheritance, because here they did the radio labeling of DNA using radioactive phosphorus. Then they did the centrifuge, and after that they were able to see the radioactivity inside the bacteria cell. So that means DNA has entered into the bacteria cell. So they were able to conclude that DNA is responsible in radioactivity. Okay. So apart from that, they discovered that DNA is a polymer of nucleotides, and then Erwin Chogoff gave the law about the composition of DNA, and so they were able to conclude that DNA is the material of or biomolecules of inheritance. So any questions? Okay, so if you have any questions, you can raise your question now, or else I can move into the next session, next part. Okay, so now we know that DNA is a polymer. DNA is a polymer of nucleotide. So you can see a nucleotide is composed of, I mean, even you guys have done this in grade 11 also, the composition of DNA. So we all know that it consists of pentose sugar, which is known as deoxyribose, and then it's also attached to the phosphate group, and then it is also attached to the nitrogenous base. So there are in DNA there are four different types of nitrogenous bases: thymine, adenine, cytosine, and guanine. thymine, adenine, cytosine, and guanine. So you can see here, this is a complete nucleotide, deoxyribose sugar, phosphate group, and the nitrogenous base. And this is very important because this part is known as the 5' end, because this is carbon number 1, carbon number 2, carbon number 1, carbon number 2, carbon number 3, carbon number 4, and carbon number 5. So to the carbon number 5, phosphate group is attached. So this part, this side is known as the 5' end. And this side is known as 3' end, because here we have open OH group at the carbon number 3. So this is 3' end and this is 5' end. This is identifying this 5' and the 3' is very important, because when it's come to the DNA replication, you will learn this, that in DNA polymerase, usually the polymerization occur from 5' to 3', 5' to 3'. Always the direction is 5' to 3'. So, okay, guys. So now there is one reason that it should be 5' to 3'. I will explain that also to you when we discuss the structure further. So now, so the problem was, now okay, after identifying DNA as the genetic material, the challenge was to determine how, what is its structure? How does it look like? That was the question. So, Maurice Wilkins and Rosalind D. Franklin, they use a technique known as X-ray crystallography to study the molecular structure of DNA. So, Rosalind Franklin, she was able to produce a picture of DNA molecule using this technique. So this was the picture that was taken by Rosalind Franklin using the technique known as X-ray diffraction or X-ray crystallography. So this image enables Watson and Crick to deduce the structure of the DNA, especially deduce it as a helical structure. So even though we say that this is the Watson and Crick structure, actually that structure is based on the findings of Rosalind Franklin. But at that time, she didn't get the credit for her work. But later on, the scientific community, they identify her contribution towards this. So, when they look at this pattern, it suggested that DNA molecule is a double helix. DNA molecule is a double helix, and it is anti-parallel. DNA molecule is a double helix and it's antiparallel. Antiparallel means here it's 5', 3', this side is 3', then the 3' end connected to the 5' end of the other strand. So this is antiparallel. You will see that when you look at the 3D structure, the hydrogen bondings are not possible if you are going to make it parallel. If you are going to make it parallel, when you see the structure, you will understand that if you are going to make it parallel, then the hydrogen bonds are not possible. to make between these two strands. So that is why these two strands of DNA are anti-parallel. Okay, so you can see here 5' end, 3' end. Then the other side, in the other strand, you have the 5' end and the 3' end. And in between the nitrogenous bases, there are hydrogen bond. So, at the beginning, the Watson and Crick thought the bases paired like adenine and adenine, and then guanine and guanine likewise. But if it happens, then the problem is there won't be a uniform gap between the two strands, because we know that the purine bases and pyrimidine bases, when you compare the size, it's different. So if it is like, you know, now these are two purine bases, these are two pyrimidine bases. Now if purine makes hydrogen bonds between another purine, and then if pyrimidine makes a hydrogen bond with another pyrimidine, then purine and purine would be too wide, and pyrimidine would be too narrow. So the best option was to have purine and pyrimidine, especially when they see the gap between the two strands. This was evident, because if it was purine, then the gap should be wider. If it was pyrimidine and pyrimidine, gap should be too narrow. So somehow they were able to deduce that it is purine and pyrimidine. So adenine makes two hydrogen bonds with thymine, and then guanine makes hydrogen bonds with cytosine, three hydrogen bond. So this is how they formed the hydrogen bond. And you will see, if this is parallel, if you made this structure into a parallel, then the hydrogen bonds are not possible. Only when it is anti-parallel, the hydrogen bonds are possible. Because if you move it in the other way around, if you make it parallel, adenine and thymine parallel to each other, then the formation of hydrogen bonds will not be possible. So and then with this the structure of the DNA, they were able to give a brief idea about how the replication of DNA occurs. So we know that the two strands of DNA are complementary to each other. So during the replication of DNA, each strand acts as a template for the new strand. So what happens is that in the DNA replication, the parent molecule unwinds, and then the two new daughter strands are built based on the existing parental strand using the base pair rolling. So the replication of DNA is known as semi-conservative. It's known as semi-conservative replication. It's known as semi-conservative replication. So you can see here in the picture A, you can see the parent molecule. So they separate. Then each parental strand acts as a template to the daughter strand. So this is known as semi-conservative model. So now Actually, in order to prove this semi-conservative model of DNA replication, they did the experiment with some E. coli bacteria. So, they cultured some E. coli colonies in heavy nitrogen medium, heavy nitrogen. So that media contained heavy nitrogen in the sense radioactive nitrogen. So when you grow the culture, E. coli cultures, E. coli colonies for generations in the heavy nitrogen media, all their DNA got heavy nitrogen. All their DNA got heavy nitrogen. So you can see this dark color indicates heavy nitrogen. Dark color indicates heavy nitrogen. Actually, so if you take now this is heavy nitrogen because the E. coli for generations grew, they were cultured in culture media contained heavy nitrogen. Then they took this E. coli and they cultured it in a normal nitrogenous media. So after culturing, what happened? After the first generation, they isolated the DNA and then they did the electrophoresis. And from the electrophoresis, they only found one type of DNA. They only found one type of DNA. One type of DNA in the sense, they found hybrid DNA. Hybrid DNA in the sense DNA consists of heavy nitrogen chain and light nitrogen chain. Hybrid DNA, heavy nitrogen chain and light nitrogen chain. So how exactly this happened? So during the replication, two mother strands separates and each act as a template for the other strand. So this is the daughter strand. We take it as a light chain. So one heavy chain and one light chain. So all the DNA had one heavy chain and one light chain. So they were known as hybrid DNA. And in the next generation, now, the mother strand separates. So there are two heavy mother strands and two light mother strands. So, but the always the newly formed strands would be light. Because they we grow them in a normal media which contains normal nitrogen, not heavy nitrogen. So they were able to observe that 50% of the DNA were light and 50% were hybrid. So this proves that the semi-conservative method is correct. Semi-conservative method is correct. So these are the details about that experiment. You can see in the conservative method, if it is conservative method, then what happens? And if it is semi-conservative, you know, dispersive method, what happens? So only the semi-conservative model was proven. So now we need to look at the DNA replication. We need to look at DNA replication. Now, for some of you guys, this can be a bit difficult because this is actually can be very complex, even for the sometimes even for the undergraduate students. If you don't, get exactly what happened. So, if you have any questions, always you can ask it. And just before I start this session, this part, if you have any questions, you can post them. So I can answer if there is any part that you want me to explain again, or if you want to know any further clarifications, please ask. Anything up to here? Any questions if you have? Okay, so that means no questions, right? Okay, so, and don't worry, you can ask questions privately. So, I mean, in the chat, you can send it privately, so no one will see that. if you are shy to ask any questions, because I know these A-level kids. So, now when we look at the DNA replication, the DNA replication starts a particular site known as origin of replication, or it can be origins of replication. Usually, when it's come to the bacterial chromosome, that means the circular DNA of bacteria has one origin of replication. But for eukaryotes, they have hundreds of origins of replication in one chromosome. And in the origin of replication, the replication proceed in both directions from each origin until the entire molecule is copied. So, now, just give me a minute, I will show you, look at this carefully. And I see someone has asked question, give me some time, I will explain that also. Okay, now, okay, now think this is the DNA molecule. Okay, this is the DNA molecule. Now, this is 5' and this is 3'. If this is 5' and if this is 3', then the other strand, this should be 3' and this should be 5'. Okay. So now think the origin of replication occurs. Just imagine this is here the origin of replication is going to start. This in the middle of the DNA molecule, origin of replication is going to start. So now, then, if this is 5', then this is 3', and this is so now here this is the origin of replication. This is the origin of replication. Remember, this origin of replication starts in the will start both the direction. It will start both the direction, not only one direction. So it will go towards the left as well as the right. It will go towards the left and right. Now, so now here the origin will start. Now this part is known as a replication fork. Five prime, three prime. This is five prime. Here it's three prime. Now this is the replication fork. Now if you consider this as three prime, then here we need to have five prime end. Okay. Here we need to have five prime end. Remember, DNA polymerase always add bases from 5 prime to 3 prime direction. Always it's from 5 prime to 3 prime direction. Always always the nucleotides will be added 5 prime to 3 prime direction. The reason is, if you look at the nucleotide structure, actually for this replication you get DATPs, or like we call them deoxyadenosine triphosphate. We get triphosphates, okay, like this. We get triphosphate. So there are three phosphates groups in the nucleotide. So this is the phosphate is a 5 prime end. Then OH is the 3 prime end. OH is the 3 prime end. So always when DNA is added, the 3 prime OH should attack the two phosphates. There will be a nucleophilic attack on two phosphates. So always DNA polymerase will add from 5 prime to 3 prime direction. Always it will add to the 5 prime to 3 prime direction. So if it is 5 prime to 3 prime direction, now if this is, if this now in the same strand, now think this is strand A and strand B. So when it is go from left, this will add it very easily, 5 prime to 3 prime direction. But then this will be 3 prime to 5 prime direction. 3 prime to 5 prime, nothing will be added. So that problem is the same strand becomes a lagging and leading. We will discuss what happens in the lagging and the leading in the next slide. So, but just remember, always origin of replication starts a replication fork towards both the direction, to the left as well as the right. In bacteria, we have one origin of replication, and usually in eukaryotes, only one or there are several origins of replication. So any questions up to here?
Mr. Channa, there is a question that was directed.
Yeah.
The question ask if it is always a 50% output for all separation at all times.
Yeah, always it's 50% output in the sense it's always semi-conservative. The DNA replication is always semi-conservative. Semi-conservative in the sense you get, newly formed daughter molecule, you have an original strand and the new strand. So the daughter DNA is composed of one original strand and newly created strand. Then again, once that DNA getting replicated, again, it would be the same. So always it follows the semi-conservative method. Semi-conservative method. Like always, 50% original strand and 50% newly formed strand.
Okay. Thank you.
So this is origin of replication in bacteria, and here you can see origin of replication in eukaryotic cells. Even in archaea also it's the same thing as bacteria. Then replication fork, I actually explained you about the replication fork. It's a Y-shaped region where the new DNA strands are elongating. Then we have apart from the DNA polymerase, we have several other enzymes involved in this DNA replication. We have helicases. So they untwist the double helix at the replication fork. And there are single strand binding proteins, because once the DNA is unwind, it becomes a single strand. Now, you know, the single strands can be we have the eukaryotes, especially we have a mechanism, even some prokaryotes, they have a special mechanism to attack any single strand DNA. So we have to stabilize the single strand. One thing is it can be attacked by our own enzymes, and also it can again rejoin. So to avoid that, there are single strand binding proteins that will stabilize the single stranded DNA. So then we have topoisomerase, DNA topoisomerase. It corrects the overwindings ahead of the replication fork by breaking and rejoining the DNA strand. So the DNA polymerase, remember one thing, DNA polymerase cannot initiate the synthesis of polynucleotide. They can't just, you know, bring two nucleotides and join them. That is not the function of DNA polymerase. DNA polymerase cannot bring two nucleotides and fix them together. They can only add nucleotides to the 3' end. Nucleotides to the 3' end. It's always the nucleotides will be added to the 3'. That is why we call it 5' to 3' direction. Always you have to have an open 3' end. Open OH. Open 3' end. In the 3' end only you have this OH. And OH is responsible in the nucleophilic attack on phosphate groups. So always new nucleotides will be added to the 3' end. And to initiate the DNA synthesis or replication, we need to have primers. So these primers are RNA molecules, short RNA molecules. They are known as RNA primers. So there is another enzyme known as primase, and this primase can start adding an RNA strand or small short RNA segment to the DNA template. It can be 5 to 10 nucleotides. Actually, this is the primer concept we also used in polymerase chain reactions in PCR techniques. There we are using DNA primers, but in the natural process, in our body, when it occurs naturally, that would be the RNA primers. So you can see, this is the RNA primer, red color. This is the RNA primer. And then here there is an open 3' end. To this open 3' end, the nucleotides will be added. Nucleotides will be added. So this, this top strand will be used as a template. And then this will forms the leading strand. This will forms the leading strand. This will forms the leading strand. Okay, so now if you look at the other strand, this 5', you know, now here, this is the leading strand. Now, if you can see here, you have 3' end. So now in this strand, the bottom strand, it would be a bit difficult. We will see how it happens, because here you can have only 1' and you can start adding the nucleotide. So that is why we call it a leading strand. Then we will see how it exactly happens in the other strand, because it is known as lagging strand, and that needs several tiny RNA primers, several tiny RNA primers. Okay, so usually, as I told you, all the nucleotides that added to the growing DNA strands are nucleoside triphosphates, and it can be DATP, DGTP, DCTP, or DTTP, depending on the complementary. So you can see, likewise, the nucleoside triphosphate comes here. Then the phosphate bonds will be broken, and one phosphate bond will be formed between this OH and the phosphate. So it's always 3' to 5' direction, 3' to 5' direction. So, but the problem is, as we discussed, DNA is anti-parallel. So if one strand goes from 5' to 3', then the other strand will go from 3' to 5'. So as I explained, this can affect the DNA replication. So that is why I told you we have a leading strand and also we have a lagging strand. DNA, in the DNA synthesizer, the leading strand will continuously keeps synthesized. Like, you know, the DNA polymerase will keep adding nucleotides to the leading strand continuously. But for the lagging strand, it's a different story. So, now you can see, this is the origin of replication. So, the primer comes here. This is, if this is 5' to 3' direction, the DNA, without any problem, the DNA polymerase will continuously keep adding nucleotides, and this strand keeps continuously growing. So that is known as a leading strand. But if you see the bottom strand, if this is 5' to 3', then this one is 3' to 5'. So you can't add DNA this direction. because this is 3 prime to 5 prime direction. So towards the 3 prime to 5, like 3 prime to 5 prime, you can't add DNA. It should be 5 prime to 3 prime. So always, it should be the 5 prime to 3. That means 5 prime to 3 prime direction, in the sense, you always have to have 3 prime end in order to add a new nucleotide, because otherwise the DNA polymerase can't add any nucleotide. So the top strand, that is the leading strand, so you have RNA segment, it goes without any problem, continuously it keeps synthesizing. But if you see the bottom strand, the other one, it's anti-parallel, so you have to add several tiny segments known as Okazaki fragments. These tiny RNA fragments are known as Okazaki fragments, and then you keep adding DNA into these Okazaki fragments. But if you see the replication fork, now if one strand acts as a leading to the left, it would be lagging to the right. Now the bottom strand is lagging to the left but leading to the right. Laggings, it becomes the lagging strand to the left. This direction it's lagging, but this direction it's leading. And if you look at the top strand, towards left it's leading, but towards right it's lagging. So you can see here, this is RNA primer, this is DNA polymerase 3, and it keeps adding the nucleotide. So you can see these are the Okazaki fragments. See, so once the replication fork is open, one RNA primer will be added to the leading strand, and it keeps continually adding the DNA molecules. But here, as soon as the replication fork is created, this is the first Okazaki fragment. Then it makes the lagging strand. Then again, once it opens a little bit, the second fragment will come and bind. Then it keeps adding the DNA, or it keeps adding the nucleotide. Then once it opens further, it keeps adding the nucleotide. So this is fragment 1, fragment 2, fragment 3. So continuously to the end, this keeps occurring. Then finally, once they meet the new strand, the replication stops. Once they meet the new strand, they stop. Like, you know, once it, now the, when the second strand, lagging strand meets the first one, it stops. Then ligase comes and repair the gap. And it this Okazaki fragment is replaced by the DNA polymerase one. So you can see how exactly the leading and the lagging strands are getting formed. Now this is the top one is the leading strand, and the bottom one is the lagging strand. And once they may meet the fragments, the replication stops. Then DNA polymerase one comes and replaces the RNA Okazaki fragments by DNA. So, again, we have another mechanism which is known as the proofreading mechanism, because, you know, in the DNA replication, we can do several mistakes because there can be errors. But if the, due to these errors, the mutations can occur and also mismatch can occur. So in order to do that, we have a proofreading mechanism, because you know, if it leads to the mutation, that can be harmful. But this doesn't ensure 100% accuracy. There can be some mutations even with the proofreading mechanism. But for some extent, you can reduce the number of mutations that occur from this proofreading mechanism. Now, again, someone asked, I think I saw about the origin of replication. Origin of replication for bacteria, there is a specific sequence as the origin of replication. That sequence will determine the initiation of the origin of replication, even in the plasmids as well as the even in the normal chromosomal DNA in bacteria. In humans, there are several, like, you know, origin of replication can actually, it's not origin of replication, it would be origins of replications, and origins of replication can occur at any point when it wants to get replicated. But bacteria has a designated origin of replication. So the problem is now, when you look at the error rate, now there is a, as I told you, we have the proofreading mechanism. So because of that, error rate after proofreading is low, but you can't say it's 100% accurate or there is no error at all. There can be errors, and those errors can be lead to mutations, and most of the mutations can, you know, sometimes the mutations can be silent also. Sometimes they can have effect. Sometimes those effect can be, most of the times it can be disadvantages, and sometimes it can lead to advantages phenotypes, which drives the evolution. And we have another problem in this DNA replication, because now in bacteria, they have the circular DNA. So for bacteria, this is not a problem, but we have linear chromosomes. So because we have the linear chromosomes, after the end of the replication, always little bit of the DNA will be deleted from the chromosome. Because prokaryotes, it's not a problem, because most of them have the circular chromosome. But for us, the humans and the eukaryotes, we have linear chromosomes that may affect the length of our DNA. And also people believe that this is also a reason, you know, the shortening of the ends of the chromosome can be a reason for aging. So you can see in the lagging strand, you have to have tiny Okazaki fragment. Now, up to the penultimate segment, you can do the repair by DNA polymerase 1. But when it's come to the last Okazaki fragment, there is no way of replacing that. There is no way of replacing the last Okazaki fragment. So with each DNA replication, there is a small part of the DNA get deleted in the daughter DNA. So because of that, in eukaryotic chromosomes, we have special nucleotide sequence known as telomeres. Telomeres cannot prevent the shortening of DNA molecules, but the telomeres, actually the telomere sequence, you don't have any import, there is no gene, that's just the normal nucleotide base sequence. So because of that, it can postpone the erosion of genes, because the erosion will occur from the telomeric end, from the end. So in the end, we have the telomere sequence, and telomere sequence is not that important because it doesn't have any genes. So with the replication, only the telomeres are getting shortened, not the actual gene. And the shortening of telomeres is connected to aging. And you can see the telomere sequence of each chromosome. This is actually a fish diagram. This is actually a fish diagram, fluorescent in situ hybridization, where you get chromosomal spread. And then to the chromosomal spread, we add fluorescent labeled dye specific for the telomeric end here. And we can now, you can see the telomeric end. So, but when it's come to the germ cells, now in germ cells, if you know, now when we produce germ cells, especially sperms and eggs, now in germ cells, if this shortening of telomeres also occurs, then eventually, later stage of our life, our gametes may miss some important gene. So, there is an enzyme known as telomerases. This telomerases catalyzes the lengthening of telomere ends. It increases the length of the telomere to prevent the shortening of telomeric end in the germ cell. And also, in sometimes, even though this is only activated in the germ cell, sometimes this telomerase enzyme can be activated in the cancer cells. So it can lead to the non-stoppable growth of cancer cells or the malignant cells. Then, okay, up to here, do you have any questions? Asra, have they posted any questions? No, right?
No, Mr. Channa. No.
Excuse me?
Yes.
Why can't we use telomerases on normal cells to prevent the shortening of telomeres so we can like delay the aging process as they suggest?
Because, I mean, even our normal cells, they have a gene for telomerases. But, you know, we have a mechanism in our body known as, we regulate the expression of our genes. Okay. So, in germ cells, the production of telomerases is not regulated. I mean, the telomerases is produced in germ cells. But in the somatic cells, we don't produce that telomerase enzyme. And we don't, we don't have a method. They haven't still developed a method to produce telomerases separately and to insert into our cells. And we don't know if we do that, it can lead to cancers also. Like, you know, I mean, yes, it can be one day, it can be modified to reduce the aging, but still, we don't have a proper mechanism of using it in proper way. Because now, like most of the cancer cells, you observe this phenomena. Like, you know, normal somatic cells, the telomerase gene is silent. But in cancer cells, the telomerase gene is active under the gene expression. So because of that, now those cells can lead to endless growth. So that is also a problem. So that is why in the somatic cell, the telomerases are silent. It's regulated in that manner. And we don't have a proper mechanism how to induce this without inducing a cancer.
Okay. Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah.
Okay. So, now if you look at our DNA, this DNA is arranged into, you know, a complex of DNA and protein. So that is what known as chromatin. And actually DNA is very long. So we need to pack this very long, because we have around 28,000 genes. Apart from genes, I mean, more than genes, more than the exons, you know, like in our, when we look at our genome, we have exons and introns. And also non-genetic on DNA or the nucleotides. So more than the genes, we have actually like majority of our DNA does not code for any protein. So only the exons code for protein. So we have huge amount of DNA, but actually we need those DNA in order to stabilize our genome. Even though we have only 28,000 genes, like more than 90% of our DNA is non-coding. The coding region is very small, but however, we need that non-coding DNA. So we have to fit those DNA into the small cell. Okay, I can see a question about the, I will answer that and go ahead. So he's asking, shouldn't we have more cancers regarding gametes producing organs such as tets and ovaries than the cancer at the other places? The problem is, in gametes the gamete producing organs, this process, the activity of the telomerases is controlled because gamete cells has other mechanisms of controlling the activity of telomerases. The same way that they have telomerases, they have other mechanisms to control the activity of telomerase enzyme. But just imagine, due to a mutation, some part of our body, any other part of our body, the telomerase enzyme got activated. The gene that produced telomerase enzyme got activated. Now, if that enzyme got activated, then what happened is, now in gametes, we have a proper mechanism to contain the effect of telomerase, to regulate the effect of telomerase. But the other parts of our body, we don't have that mechanism also. So because of that, it can lead to the uncontrollable growth of the cells. And also, that is only one mechanism that causes cancer. Cancer caused by due to a lot of problems. We have two types of genes, proto-oncogenes and tumor suppressor genes. A mutation in proto-oncogene leads to the oncogene, and oncogene is responsible to cause the cancer. Or else, a mutation in tumor suppressor gene will produce inactivated tumor suppressor, which regulates the, uncontrollable cell growth. Then that can lead to the cancer. So there are so many mechanisms that lead to the cancer. But with respect to this question, our gametes have a special way to control the activity of telomerase enzyme, gametic cells. But other cells, they don't have that mechanism. So having the telomerase enzyme in gametes is not a problem. But if it occurs in the other parts of the body, then that can lead to the cancer, because in those cells, they don't have a proper tumor suppressor gene in order to control the activity of the telomerases. I mean, they have the gene, but that gene is silent. Depending on the location of the body, depending on the organ of the body, genes are activated and genes are put it into the silent mode. So depending on the location and depending on the organ. So, we have housekeeping genes. Housekeeping genes are the genes which do all the functions. So in each and every cell, those housekeeping genes are activated. But most of the other genes, depending on the location, depending on the organ, they are silent. Or depending on the location, they are in the active mode. Okay.
Okay, so there is another question which is in relatance to the same. The question is directed at, can we stop spreading of cancer cells by finding something to stop the action of the telomerase enzyme?
Yes, you know, most of these cancer medication are targeting on not only the telomerase mechanisms. There are, you know, as I told you, there are several, you can say cancer is a, you can't say it's always inherited, but it's genetic. Okay, there is a difference between genetic and inherited diseases also. So however, we can say cancer can be inherited, but then again, definitely cancer is a cancer is caused by the problems in the genes. So it's genetic disorder. So always what happens is, depending on the cancer, we know what, like, you know, not all the cancers, but depending on the type of cancer, some cancers we know what exactly has happened. Now, if you look at breast cancer, we know that BRCA1 and BRCA2 gene has a mutation. When it's come to the brain tumors, or when it's come to the tumors in the nervous system, we know that it's most probably problem in the VHL gene. Now, there are oncogenes, there are, as I told you, there are tumor suppressor genes. So when we make the cancer medication, sometimes we are targeting those oncoproteins or the tumor suppressor proteins in order to prevent the cancer. So same way, there are researchers. So I think several research on how to stop the activity of the telomerase enzyme. And then another question is there, so can't we activate the same mechanism in gametes along with the activating the telomerase enzyme in somatic cells to reduce aging? The problem is, the gene expression, now very recently only we actually understood all the genes. Still, we are learning how these gene regulation occurs, you know, methylation, acetylation. We are looking at the mutations in the DNA methyl transferase gene. So we don't have that much of knowledge yet in order to, properly regulate the gene expression of all the genes. So, our knowledge on that area is not enough in order to do these things. But yes, still those things are possibilities. But the thing is, we need to do more research on those areas in order to, to see how to, control the gene expression. Still people are doing those research, with the C. elegans and, because we can't just take the very complex organism and do this search, because they are too complex to study. So what we are trying to do is, we are taking certain, these C. elegans and some nematoda to see how gene expression occurs. You know, how these some insects, how this metamorphosis occurs. Metamorphosis also occurs due to the gene expression. So, but still, we don't have a very good knowledge, very good insight into how all these things happens. We know bits and pieces, we are trying to connect them, but still we are not that advanced in order to regulate the gene expression. If we know how to regulate the gene expression, then we can do anything. Literally, we can do anything, but we still don't know. That is a problem. Okay, so if we move into chromatin again, now I told you there are we have so much of genetic information, our DNA is so long. So we had to pack this DNA into the nucleus. So we have to arrange them into the chromosome. So usually when it's come to the interface, chromatin is organized into about 10 nanometer fibers, but sometimes they are compacted into 30 nanometer fibers due to the foldings and looping. Now you can see in this picture, you can see this is the DNA double helix. So this DNA double helix will arrange into a nucleosome. They will wrap twice and they arrange into the nucleosome. You can see these are the nucleosomes. You can see the picture of the nucleosomes also. They will be arranged into the nucleosomes along with the histone protein. Then again, these nucleosomes again will arrange into different folded structures. Like this, see? The nucleosomes then again will form a 30 nanometer fiber structure. Then those 30 nanometer fiber structure will arrange into loops. Then loops will arrange into scaffolds. Then finally, they will arrange into the chromatids and the chromosomal structure. So now most of the chromatins, if you look at, they are loosely packed and they are known as euchromatin. But during interphase, there are some regions where the chromatins are condensed, highly condensed. They are known as heterochromatin. Now, heterochromatin region, actually this heterochromatin formation is also a one way of controlling the gene expression, because when the chromatins are in heterochromatin structure, it's a bit hard or difficult for the cell to express the genetic information coded in these regions. So in some cells the DNA that we don't want to express, genes that we don't want to express, will be methylated, and that is also known as imprinting, sometimes acetylated. Then due to this methylation and acetylation, they form dense structure known as heterochromatin, which reduce the gene expression. Not only DNA, but also histones can undergo some chemical modification in order to arrange the chromatin. Okay, guys. So, this is up to, today we can cover up to this structure of the chromatin. And we did discuss about the DNA replication and the introduction of the DNA structure. So I think, if I do further, I don't think you guys can concentrate. So we are going to stop from here. But what we will do is, we will be doing several other webinars also for the same lesson, starting from the next part. So you guys, if you are interested, you can join to those webinars as well. If you want, you can ask your question. You better to type then and post it so that I can. Yes, I will be doing the recombinant DNA technology, but not today. So probably next week or week after next week, we will arrange the other webinar for the recombinant DNA technology. We are going to finish this lesson, don't worry. The chapters, unit 7, it's a little bit long chapter, but we are going to finish this. And guys, this is, I think most of you know this, right? The local A-level students, the Sri Lankan A-level student, this is your reference book. I hope you guys know what is your reference book for A-levels. Earlier days, we had the green book, but now for the local A-levels, the reference book is Campbell Biology. So these lectures are based on that Campbell biology book. That is your reference book for A level biology. Earlier, we had biological science by NPO Green, and I'm not remember other name, that was known as a green book, but now we are not using green book for the local A levels. When they do the paper marking and when they make the marking scheme, it's based on the Campbell biology. Any other questions? So hope it's clear for all of you guys. So in case if you have any questions, you can always send us an email. And also we will share the video with you. And also the lecture materials, we will try to share it with you guys. We can make a Google Classroom and add you guys into that, and then we'll try to do something.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Channel, for delivering a comprehensive lecture which would immensely benefit the students preparing to sit for the forthcoming advanced level examinations. I would like to thank the audience for the time taken to attend these sessions and for the active participation by directing questions, making the session interesting for everyone. Hope this session
question is there.
Yeah.
Okay. Why is primer DNA in PCR and RNA cell? Because there is no way of making DNA primers inside our body. So we can only make RNA primers. We have RNA polymerase and the other enzymes to do in our cells. We can make RNA primers, but we can't make DNA primers in our body. If we can make DNA primers, is the telomeres and all these things will not be a issue. But in PCR, we use DNA primers because DNA primers can bind to DNA well than RNA, because you need to get a proper product. So that is why in PCR, we are using DNA primers. Because if you are going to make RNA primers in the PCR, then in the PCR, we have to increase the temperature, for tac polymerase and also unwinding of DNA and everything. So because of that, if you have RNA primers, RNA primers are not suitable during the PCR due to the high temperature and everything that we use. And also it doesn't bind to the DNA properly. So that is why when we do PCR, we use DNA primer. We can make DNA primers outside, artificially. But inside our cells, we don't have a mechanism to make DNA primers. So Okazaki fragments from DNA. I hope that you understood that, right? Okay.
Okay, so if anyone has any further questions, you're more than welcome to type in. Okay, so as I was telling, I was thanking the audience for participating in this session that we have carried out. Hope this session has been beneficial, and like mentioned by Mr. Channa, we would be continuing with the second part of this session. I would like to also extend my gratitude to the management of Spectrum Institute of Science and Technology for making this a possibility, for initiating such sessions. And also, a few students have asked me if we would be providing the recorded version. Yes, so we would be providing the recorded version of the webinar session. We will be emailing this video to your personal email that has been provided to us. Also, you could access these videos publicly, like it would be available in the YouTube channel, that is the Spectrum Institute YouTube channel. So anyone could have a look at those as well. And another message that was extended out is, how can we join the future classes? So when we are having the next session, we would be sending you the link to your emails that you have given or used during your registration. Okay, so also we would be doing the advertising round again. So when you see the advertisement, you can re-register yourself. So students who have registered again need not re-register. We will send you the information and the link to your emails. And another message is, can we register as a new member? You need not register as a new member if you have already registered, but if any one of your friends are interested to join the session, they are more than welcome to register, and then we would provide them the link. So with respect to the technical issues, I think that is clear, and how we would be sending in the details. Also, like Mr. Channa said, we would create a Google Classroom and add you people to the Google Classroom so that we can share our online resources with the people who are interested. So we will send you an email shortly on more details on how you could join our Google Classroom and share the online resources, which would be immensely helpful for your examination. Yes, so Mr. Nishen has shared a link. So if there are any students who still have not registered, if any one of your friends are interested, please send them the link so that they could register and join for our future classes as well.
And in next session, we can show you guys how the recombinant DNA, those techniques carried out in Sri Lanka, and how the gel electrophoresis and these the transforming the bacterial colonies, how those experiments are carried out in Sri Lanka in our labs. We can show those videos as well.
Okay. Thank you for a very successful session, and wish everyone a very good night, and hope to see you in the next sessions.